So today I will be presenting one of the activities of that kind. The remaining more historical issues, more well established evidences which I have brought out as a book also, the book is kept outside the exhibition, will be taking up tomorrow. Now if you see our ancient text, read any of the Puranas or even the Vedic texts, many times you know the objects, what we today call objects, they are personified. There are legends, there are myths, there are stories about them. And they would be talking of demons, they would be talking of Rakshasas, or they would be talking of divine beings flying here and there, all kinds of things. Some of these you can easily say, look, this is a physical kind of object from today's perspective as an engineer or as a scientist. Say if a demon fell down from sky on the earth and a hole was made and he went inside, this kind of story comes up in the Puranas. It should only be a meteorite, a rock falling and making a crater and going down. In Puranas there are many such things. In fact, these are geological kind of myths. These are called in modern times geomyths, and earth scientists do work on geomyths in all countries, not only in India. And for international development of geological sciences, earth sciences in the most ancient period, geomyths are very important. Location of craters, they are done through these kind of mythical things only. Otherwise, you can't easily locate a crater. There would have been residents sealed and all kinds of things. Well, anyway, this personification has gone in so many ways in our text, the Sanskrit text, the legend of Dhruva. I will not explain it because this is my main topic. There are other legends like Somapana. Somapana, you know, is a drinking. People would take it lightly and say even the villagers know that Indra drank Soma and he became, and all kinds of things, dramas are associated with it, so many things. But that Somapana, is it always a spirituous drink? Many of the Western Indologists write about Soma Yaga, Soma and all these things. They take it only in that sense, that it was either a kind of a mushroom or something which they crushed and took it up and kind of, they might have done it. I am not telling it was not there. But Soma legend is not just that. So tomorrow we will say what is Soma legend and why, how many gods drank Soma, they count that number and given in the Rig Veda. So when, once numbers come, in fact science starts with numbers. So why did they count them? See, if you say something, you say the stars, nakshatras are 27, but 27 are the main nakshatras. There are totally 86. Each nakshatra has other groups and the count is given. How many are there is given. So that the whole thing is established in a proper manner to the accuracy available in those days. What are those days? That is the question. That is the history. So that is what I want to come to. And then there are also legends which can easily be associated with what is called precision. So today we know the earth rotates on its axis, and as it rotates, it also makes the axis makes a slow motion as a top, as a spinning. It takes 27,000 years for one complete revolution. That is precession of the equinoxes. That legend is there in all cultures, not only in India, and that is there in these legends. I will come to it a little bit today, but more tomorrow. So there are so many other things, I will not go through it. It's the Parashara Tantra, as I said, because many the ancient texts about Indian culture, people would say Indians knew only the lunar zodiac, they did not know about the solar zodiac. And they would say, compare this with the newspaper forecasts which are given, Rashi in Hindi and local languages, whereas sun signs in English newspapers say, look, they had this solar zodiac, you didn't have it. It's all absurd. So what was the technical issue with solar zodiac we have to see, not with the astrology, is the scientific thing. Later on astrology might have taken some scientific aspects and became another subject altogether, based mainly on quite a few superstitions and other. Again another interesting thing is there, which I will be covering tomorrow, that is on the 6 monthly eclipse periods of the lunar eclipse was known. You know that you would have heard that even in the high school textbooks it is written, Saros cycle of 18 years, it was Babylonians knew it, or it was from the Chaldeans and the Indians took it and so on and so forth. And even today, if you know your Janma Kundali kind of business, there you know there is a Rahu Dasha which is valid for 18 years, so it is the eclipse cycle and all that it said. But 18 years they knew in some other sense, but they knew a 6-monthly lunar eclipse period. How did they know it? And if there was mathematics already in those periods to know that at 6 months is a possibility, or was it an observation? If it is an observation, when did it happen? You can, through modern astronomy, it should be possible to establish, and it would give us a dating. So these are the interesting things which one can do along these lines. Then you know, of course, there are also the Puranas. I have slowly come to this, because the Puranas, after the Vedic period, there are many issues concerning Puranas. I will come to it again much later. Now, why this pole star? I have to worry about it. All of us have heard about Dhruva. I am sure. Has anybody who has not heard of the Dhruva legend? You can raise your hand, because I may know that also. You know. So I take it every one of you. Briefly, you know the legend that Dhruva was the son of king by name Uttanapada. And he had the king had two wives, Suniti and Suruchi. Dhruva was the son of the first queen, Suniti. But the second queen was dearer to the king. So he was always partial to the second wife and her son, but not to the first one. So then Dhruva was one day goes to the father's thing, and then all those stories I will not repeat it. Then he goes and does tapas as a child. And then after several hundred years or thousand years or whatever, he realizes Vishnu and then so on and so forth, and he gets a boon that he can become the pole star, because the pole star always remains fixed. So you are Dhruva. So the meaning of the word Dhruva is important in Sanskrit. It means fixed. So the property of what the star we are talking is to be fixed. Should not move. Please remember that, because that question is important for our analytical investigation further. Now today, if I talk of a pole star, this is what we do. This is the pole star, it is the Saptarshi, the Big Bear, and one would say draw a straight line from this, you can meet the pole star. Roorkee in the beautiful skies, you can see it in the night if you have not seen, and you can locate this pole star. And what is the pole star as per the International Astronomical Union? It is here. It is the last star on the Ursa Minor constellation. There is a constellation and also stars. You have to discriminate, because even in Sanskrit these discriminations are there, even though unfortunately they are forgotten. And this is the star, and it is going to be the pole star. Means fixed means it will be here, but what is it which rotates then? If it has to be fixed, it is relative always. With reference to what it is fixed? These things rotate. In the night if you see, these rotate, these stars, but this remains there only. And if it is a slightly far away, this also would rotate. This please remember, because later on in the Puranas, it describes the rotation of Dhruva also. That is why it is important. Now, from modern astronomy, we know that, and when I heard this story as a young boy, later on when I was reading the Sanskrit books in the originals, as he was mentioning, I came across this, and then I wondered, how is it the modern astronomers say something else? As per modern astronomy, I will come to this again later on, there was no pole star for a long period from about 2000 BC to about 1500 AD. There was no pole star. The present pole star came to its position. This is another diagram which we will explain later on. This is the Polaris. 2000 AD only it has come. Actually 1500 AD it came very near that. Before that it was not there. And the modern analysis says in 3000 BC there was a pole star called Thuban. That is the modern name. That is the pole star. And this was the pole star which was known to the Egyptians. This is the pyramids you can see. You can do a Google search, you can find out. There is a big theory on that. In the pyramid, you know, the king's chamber was aligned with Thuban, and they show that the openings are like this and which go directly to the northern constellation. That constellation is called Draco. That is called Draco even today. The modern astronomy is called Draco. This is the argument given, and We know that Egyptian things can be dated, has been dated to around 3000 BC without much difficulty based on other considerations, and hence this is a possibility, and they say that this is the philosophy behind them. They had to be kept, the mummies, seeing the Draco, because heaven was supposed to be there. That was the heaven. That is where they wanted to go or whatever. You can see later on there is some correspondence here also in our literature also on that. So my interest was in this, and I will just show you a, what you see. This yellow thing is the sun. This is the ecliptic. This is earth, which is inclined 23 degrees. You see the northern axis where it is pointing. These are the stars which you see in the north. And these two points are the equinoxes. Yeah, the same figure which I showed previously, because earth and the ecliptic, they are inclined, the axes are inclined, and like a top, it makes a slow motion for 27,000 years to complete one circle, nearly 27,000 years. So you can see that, I think we can remove that. Yeah, we can go back to the original one, you know. Yeah, you can close it. So, between the previous, we have seen that short movie, the pole star, what human beings were able to see on the earth in the northern hemisphere, I am telling, I am not talking about the southern hemisphere, it changed from 3000 BC to nearly 1500 AD. There were some minor other stars which are near the North Pole, but they are not fixed. They were not Dhruvas. Dhruvas, there are only two, what we have today and what was there, the Thuban, about around 3000 BC. Now the next step is, in Indian literature, Sanskrit literature, also there are two Dhruvas. A Dhruva came up much later, around 1500 AD, I will show you that. The astronomers were very strong in India from Aryabhata onwards. You know, they looked at the sky, they did all kinds of mathematical computations, very advanced mathematical things they did. What did they do about Dhruva? They called, there was a Dhruva Matsya. There was a fish, it was called a Dhruva Matsya. That is the name they gave for a constellation near the North Pole. They did not talk about the Vedic Dhruva. There is a very interesting thing which comes up. And when you see such a dichotomy or differences, you can see there should be some secret there. Some peculiar information is contained of cultural importance or religious importance, what you may say. So how to investigate it? So the oldest literature, you have to do only a literature review, nothing more than that. That means you have to read the ancient texts. I started with the oldest one which is available, that is the Vedas. So many of you would have been already exposed to the Vedas also. They are large, in fact there are about 200 texts which are considered Vedic. There are only four actually with two branches of Vedas, and each have four arms. This itself will make you 20 important books, but there are ancillary books are there which multiplied by another 5 and 10, there are about 200 books or so. Now what is the fidelity of this text, what is the accuracy of this text is the next question. Because as I said, there are many things which are legendary, which are in a kind of anthropomorphic way, but it is about the sky. So when they talk about the sky, let them talk about a war in the sky. So what is it? How did they come to that conclusion there is a war in the sky? What did they observe? Is there anything which is correlatable linguistically and also scientifically with some scientific issues, what we call science as today? Important thing is, science need not have been done in the only way that we are doing today. This is the Western way of doing, this is the Aristotelian way as they call it, from whom it has come, and we are doing it. Fine, perfectly fine, nothing wrong in it, but the need not be the only way. What is the alternate? The alternate that we had was what I would call a scientific naturalism. So how did that scientific naturalism came up? You can see a brief I am going to give in this. So what I did was I went through so many texts and finally honed up on a text called Taittiriya Aranyakam, which belongs to the Krishna Yajurveda. This is available in print nowadays. Why I am mentioning this is available in print? All these texts were oral, let us remember that. They were orally transmitted for 1000 years or more, thousands of years, and sometime they were put on palm leaf manuscripts. Not all, but many of them were put on palm leaf manuscripts. Palm leaf manuscripts stay only for 200 years, 300 years. Then somebody will have to rewrite. If it is not rewritten, it is gone. It is totally gone. So we don't know what has gone. But what is available in oral tradition to this day and the manuscripts, large number have been printed, fortunately, after 1850. And this text is very interesting. I am just making a brief presentation so you get a feeling to what this text is about. This is all on the contents is about earth and the sky. Most of the things in the Vedic text are about the earth, atmosphere and the sky. Large number of things are concerned with it. That is the environment in which we are living. And that is the environment which they also talk. They talked in a different language. We have to convert it and see whether there is anything which overlaps with our sense. And I am not going to do anything, any interpretation on my own. I will not do that. Tradition itself has given some interpretation. Those traditional interpretation of ancient Sanskrit texts themselves will lead to some scientific conclusions. This text very beautifully says, Smritihi Pratyaksham Aitihyam. It's a Sanskrit club, so I should read it in Sanskrit. Anumanas Chatushtayam Yetaihi Aditya Mandalam Sarvaireva Vidasyate. Smriti Pratyaksha. Smriti is memory. Pratyaksha is directly seeing, observation. Aitihyam, it is a legendary or what our previous people have said. And Anumana, that is inference, the logic. These are the four things with which what can be done? Sarvaireva, all can understand Aditya Mandalam. Sun can be understood by anyone by these four methods. That is what it starts with. That is the premise. So once a person starts with such a premise, you can see whether it is scientific or unscientific. They might have come to wrong conclusion is a different matter. I am not bothered about it. But the approach is 100% scientific. And later on, why they did this? They started with the seasons. They had to establish the seasons. It is easy for people to say that agricultural country, so they looked into the lunar calendar, solar calendar and all that, and it depend on the rain. Okay, but how did they establish the seasons? Is it that from the day the first rain falls, I call it Varsha Ritu or the rainy season? It cannot be done. Is it that the winter season starts exactly when I feel shivering? So it is a transition region. As we know that, there is a transition. It is not a quantum jump which happens like that. How did the transition to be fixed? It is very important. They did it anecdotally by social considerations. The social considerations was if somebody is kind of having rough eye and akshi dukkha he says and it is tears are falling and his eyes have become yellow, then it is going to be starting of the Varsha Ritu is what he says. And he gives other considerations, I will not go into all the six. It is important because the foundation of astronomy is season determination, whether Indian, whether Babylonian. Because all Greek astronomy has been taken from Babylonia. The fundamentals are all taken from Babylonia. The Babylonian astronomy is initially season zodiac, four seasons, whereas we had six seasons. That difference is the key factor which tomorrow I will discuss. But this text discusses the seasons, that is why I started with it, because it's fundamental to astronomy. Then it also talks about the stars, rishis who have become stars. And these rishis are the most important for our discussion here. Who are these? Rishayaha Sapta Atrishchayate Sarve Atrayo Agastyascha Nakshatray Shankruto Avasan. This is a mantra. It is repeated in all religious functions and all that. What it means is the seven stars, these Sapta Rishis, which you know is the Ursa Major, which is there even now, you can identify easily. And not only that, Agastya. Agastya is a southern star. They are living with the nakshatras is this statement. That means it should have happened after their time. After their sojourn on the earth, they were identified with the stars. That belief even today continues that good people become stars in the sky and all that. All over India such legends are there. And once you see, get such a statement, you can believe in the text to a large extent because it is giving some physical relationship with the sky, because always sky and the earth were connected in the Vedic period. They did not isolate as we have isolated ourselves, but they thought they were one with the universe. So like the sky, they were also living maybe here, but they were one with the sky. Now Why this is important, you will see in the next slide. Agastya is a very interesting star. Now, Saptarshis, if you had known, they are circumpolar. They used to be circumpolar, not anymore, but they used to be. That means they would never set, they would always be in the visible in the night times in the northern direction. Such stars are of interest, no doubt, but there are stars which have visibility in them. Visibility means only during certain periods in a year they are visible, otherwise they are not visible. That is the visibility factor comes into picture. Now, Agastya is one such star, so important for our history. So, what is that history you can see here? This is a paper in 2005 by Iyengar, who was professor of astronomy in University of Hyderabad. He is a very famous astronomer, and in fact, it is important for Parashara Tantra, my book also, that is why I am showing. He showed that this southern star Canopus, as it is called in modern astronomy, which you can easily simulate on any of your planetarium software and see. After all, this is a shot I have taken from the stellarium software. Agastya would have been visible in North India, that is in this region, only after about 3500 BC. Before 3500 BC, Agastya was not visible, again due to precession. So, as precession comes into picture, some of the southern stars come and they vanish after a long time. And this has been calculated, you can see for Delhi, it was somewhere around 3100-3500 BC. After another 3000 years, it will no more be visible in these latitudes. And if you go still north to Jammu, only around 1500 BC it was visible, and later on it will vanish after another 1500 years. But in the south, of course, it was visible even earlier, around 8000 BC. But for the Vedic thing, we are considering only the Indo-Gangetic plain, the Saraswati river basin is the northern region is what I am considering. So, this is important for dating purposes. What I am showing here is from the Parashara's thing, because Taittiriya Aranyaka already showed, mentioned about Agastya. This is Agastya, was visible in minus 1300, that is 1300 BC from Pushkar. But remember this, and I have given two more information here. Why is it important? It is invisible even today if you go north of 34 degrees. It is visible only for people living south of 34 degrees north latitude. That is, it is visible to us. It is not visible in Rome. It is not visible in Greece. They would not have seen this. Some southern tip they might have come and seen, otherwise it is not visible. Russia, no, just Moscow and those, they don't know, because they are going towards the north. And hence all Agastya legends, there are plenty of Agastya legends in India, and Agastyodaya is a religious function in North India, particularly in Bengal. During September or so, the almanacs give the date of Agastyodaya and they have to do some worship and all that. This gives us very interesting further information on chronology. Yeah, this is the book which I have shown in greater detail in Kurukshetra when it was visible, in Pushkar when it was visible, from which date. Visible initially only for 10 days, 15 days. You don't expect a person to have seen it and then recorded it. It should have been visible for a longer time than only. Morning visibility, evening visibility. That is also important. It is a south star. It is not a eastern star like the regular nakshatras. Hence, this is a very important information. Now, what is the next thing? Why that Vedic text I have been talking? I showed you about Saptarshi, it knows. It knows about Agastya, so you can believe it. One northern constellation, one southern star. It also knows one more. That is where Dhruva comes into picture. This is a mantra. So, we think that all the Vedic things are holy, sacred, no doubt they are for us because it's already 5000 years old, we have to respect them. This is a mantra which is uttered even today, supposed to be for meditation. So, Dharmo Murdhanam Brahma Uttarahanuhu Yajna Adhara Vishnuhu Hridayam, it goes like this. And it comes, then says Puchasya Prathamam Kandam, that is a tile somewhere, and that tile's first part is Indra, then comes Prajapati, then the fourth one is going to be Abhaya, he is called. Agni, then Indra, then Prajapati, then the fourth one is Abhaya, is the name which is given. But what is this figure? This figure, the mantra itself says further, because it's a very archaic way of telling things. Sava yesha divyah shakvaraha shishumaraha. This person whom I explained previously is a divine celestial shakvara, is an animal. Shakvara is an animal in Sanskrit. It is a celestial animal. This is the celestial animal figure. And what did it say previously? How did it describe the animal figure? It is again interesting. It says the head is Dharma, it is called Dharma. The Brahman is the upper jaw, Uttara Hanuhu. Yajna is the lower jaw. Vishnu is the Hridayam, is the heart of this figure is Vishnu. Then it says so many things, where are the Ashwins and where are the Mitra Varanas. And at the tip is, who is called Abhaya. And this Abhaya is identified with, I have given one table here, this is the Puranic names. The Puranic names are same. I will come to the Puranic thing slightly later. Except this Brahma is replaced by Uttanapada, whose son is Dhruva actually, as per this story. And the same mantra continues and says, Dhruvastvamasi, Dhruvasya Kshitamasi. You are the fixed person. You are the fixed person around whom all living beings go around you. And I salute you, Shishukumaraya Namaha. And this is the Shishumara, who is also called the here. Shishumara sometimes in some readings, Shishukumara in some other readings. Both of you can take it. And Shishumara is actually a animal, a whale, a gharial, or a crocodile, or a porpoise. It is an aquatic animal. This aquatic animal thing is also important for our discussion. Come to that. Now, I will quickly go through these things. I have already translated. This is the constellation Shishumara. Like we had the constellation of you had other constellations. This is a constellation because it's the important question, because some of the Western astronomers, historians write that Indian astronomy did not know about representing constellations with animal figures. So the Mesha Vrishabha are supposed to be later ones borrowed from the Greeks. Whereas this is an animal figure and this is a constellation. Why this is a constellation? Is it correct? We have to go through these things a little bit further more. Yeah. If we followed so far what we have done, we can go to a planetarium figure. This is 2830 BC. This is how the pole star would have been there, and the constellation you can identify in those days is only this. This is what is called in modern times a Draco. And this looks like a peculiar animal, a whale or a crocodile figure, if you can imagine that on the board. Or you can try your luck even in the sky and come to your own conclusion. But the moderns represent the Greeks as a dragon. So this is the figure which is given if you want a figure for it, as per the modern astronomical mythology you want it. Now, this is the International Astronomical Union figure. Official figure for Draco is here. I think you can't see that clearly. But this is the present day Ursa Minor, but Draco is here. You can later on see that also. And Allen is a very famous person. He's an astronomer. His book is referred even to this day, Star Names and Their Meanings. He says he knew that the Hindus, from whom the Greeks are said to have borrowed, although the reverse of this may also have been the case, knew it as Shishumara, that is the Draco, he says. But there are alternates given, because that is our own mistake. Because many times we use the same word for several objects, and that is where the difficulty is coming. This I have already explained to you, the top example also in your classes this would have been given. And you see a better figure here. This is the Draco figure, and this is the Abhaya which I was mentioning during the Vedic period. This is the only thing, this is the polar circle. Unless and until a star is on this, it is not a fixed pole star. It can indicate a northern direction. That is possible, because you would see in the books people who oppose, we'll come to that if there is time later on, they will say so many other things also. But you can see the fixed one could have been only in 2800 BC to 3000 or plus or minus 100 years. If you go by this, this star should have been identified as the Vishnu, called Sadhya Vishnu in the Vedic period. Not that they took Vishnu was sitting there or anything. Let us not make that mistake. They had a region deities, that is the forces or some powers which are identified with the various celestial objects. because they could not go there. So they identified some names, like the Saptarshis were given names, Atri, Bhrugu, Kutsa kind of thing. Here also they gave some names of gods, which are going to be Brahma, Dhruva, all these things. Later on, the Puranas, to continue this story, otherwise you know this is dry and Vedic thing with you have to utter it with so many modulations and all that, people would forget. It has to go to the common people also. So the Puranas developed their mythologies to preserve these things. So it is important, science also has to be preserved for the common man. How do you do it? It is not telling A plus B whole square equals this, that nobody will listen, they will go out. You have to put it in some other way, in a figurative way. That is what has been done. Now, another important question, you can oppose me. If you have any opposition, you can also raise your hand and ask me. If it was so that in 3000 BC, the Aranyaka, what it says, was in fact the Thuban of the Draco constellation and it was the Dhruva, what happened to it later on? Because you yourself said, modern astronomy says there was no Dhruva from 1500 BC to 1500 AD. Then how do you argue about it? Yes, you can see that there is reference and evidence for that in the Sanskrit texts themselves. That what they were calling Dhruva as fixed, there is a text called Maitraini Aranyaka, again of the Yajurveda. It's a very beautiful thing because it gets into Vedanta and all that. But Vedantic things I will not cover up here. The king by name Brihadratha questions a sage. Everything is transient in this world. That is how this starts, sentence. And he goes on to say his pessimism is so great and deep. Maharnavanam shikarinam prapatanam. Even the great things, you know, from the mountains, they are all falling down. Landslides, maybe he was referring to. They are all falling down. And then Dhruvasya prachalanam. Even Dhruva is moving. Even Dhruva is moving. And Vatarajuna Nimajjanam. This Vatarajju is supposed to be, I had no time for that, but it is in the Siddhantic astronomy that the planets, how are they controlled is the question. They assume there are invisible strings, you know, light strings or whatever, with the help of which they are controlled in their relative position, is what they say. That concept is from the Vedic period. This Vatarajuna Nimajjanam means even the planets which they were, he was imagining at a particular point, they have gone down. Which was visible has become invisible, precession effect again coming into picture and vice versa. So there is definitely a reference that Dhruva was drifting. There is also more reference to this. And when this could have happened, this Maitraini Aranyaka itself has some statements which details I will not go into again, because it says the season of the cold season, the winter season, there is a winter solstice, started when sun was in the center of Dhanishta Nakshatra. Whereas in the Vedanga Jyotisha period, if it has already been covered by somebody, it was 1400 BC, whereas this would have been possible half star away, that is about 6.5 degrees prior. So 72 degrees precision, 72 years per degree, if you keep it, you can easily get about 450 years or so, and this is datable to about 1600 BC, this text or this statement. I won't say the text because how the text came we don't know, it was oral, but this observation should belong to 1600 BC. So it is the same text which says why Dhruva is moving, which was not of text of 3000 BC or whatever, but of a later period. And you come to the Puranas, this is the Brahmanda Purana. See, the story of Dhruva as the legend, what you hear in the Kathas and Dhruva Katha and other things, you know, Haridwar and other places, that is from the Vishnu Purana, mostly from the Vishnu Purana. Whereas the Brahmanda Purana is a Purana earlier to Vishnu Purana. Brahmanda Purana doesn't have that legend of Dhruva sitting on the lap of his father and all that. That is why this Purana is not popular. This is more a scientific Purana because this is about cosmology. Brahmanda is cosmology, it discusses cosmology in the first half. In fact, excellent text, which I believe it should be about somebody is interested in how these things were studied. It's very simple Sanskrit, where Sanskrit club people can easily follow this, you know. It should be included in the curriculum. What it says, it discusses the Shishumara here, and in about 250 verses, it discusses astronomy of its days, a modeling, and also Dhruva. And where is Dhruva? He says, Bhuta Sammohanam Etate, I can't read it, Nibodhata, something, Pratyakshamapi Drishyancha Sammoheti Yat Prajaha. He says, you see in the northern sky, there is something there which mesmerizes you. It is something is so interesting, it mesmerizes you. What is that mesmerizing thing which is happening? He says, Uttanapada Putraso Medi Bhuto Dhruvo Divi. The son of Uttanapada has become the fixed Medi. That is the pivot. Pivot of the whole earth. He has become the pivot. And that, why is he saying that? Savai Brahmayate Nityam Chandraditya Grahisaha. He is controlling Chandra and Surya along with all the planets. He is rotating them, he says. So this is not geocentric, this is not heliocentric, this is Dhruva centric. Says the Dhruva is controlling and holding that. But where is the motive power? He explains that also further. Well, anyway, there are so many things, and he gives two models. One is called the Tailapeeda Yatha Chakra. Tailapeeda is a Gani, is an oil mill. I think Kanjarpur may still have a Gani, I don't know. It may be there, which is the oil mill. I will show the figure later on. That is one of the models. The other model he gives is the Potter's Wheel. The Potter's Wheel also is something like that. And it discusses in very great detail, all the 14 stars are given, and this 14 is important. The number is important, even in the Veda, even in the Purana, everywhere. That 14 star he keeps on, and we have a conflict with Al-Biruni when we come to the 11th century. Till that time we have no conflict with this number 14. And that has itself a story behind it. Now he says that, and also they are so particular, the last four do not set. Is the circumpolar, the last four of this constellation which I showed. Why are they telling that? It was important for navigation. When the Vedic text knew this, it's a circumpolar star, you can use it for navigation. There is a mantra in another text which is used for navigation. It says this is Shishumara mantra. That is, use it for navigation, you will safely cross the ocean, which says. They took an equivalent in not only cross the physical ocean on the earth, you can also cross the samsara ocean also philosophically by worshipping the Shishumara who is in the sky. That is the connection they had, because always sky and the earth were connected. This is a very long thing, so I will come to this. This is the, you can say the Potter wheel. What he wants to say is, the Dhruva is sitting here, the all other things are rotating. He is slowly rotating, no doubt. But he is sitting also, he is fixed also in the center. That is how you have to take it. And he says that Kulala Chakra Nabhischa Yata Tatraiva Vartate. The center of the Potter wheel stays there only, right? Like the Dhruva is also there, but he also rotates. Everything is what he is telling. Then somebody thought they need a better model. That is the Gani model. So the comparison here is Tailapeeda Yatha Chakravarti. What he says is, this is the Medi. Medi means only a pole, you know. This is a central pole is what is called Medi. Later on it became Meru. Today also that word is used. Siddhantic astronomers use that for cosmology. Jains and Buddhists also use this cosmology model. They don't use Dhruva, because by the time these philosophies evolved, there was no Dhruva. But they used this concept. So you can see how things get forgotten in culture, but the relevant concepts are remembered and they are used for some particular purposes. So what he says in the Purana is like an oil mill. This part, here of course the motive power is from the bullocks. They rotate this row. He says no. This is at the center, Dhruva is anyway rotating. Forget how he is the god, he is the final power for everything. And he rotates, and these are the planets. So the planets rotate. If you rotate this, they can also rotate. So he required only an inclined thing. That inclination is the obliquity. So they had an idea of the obliquity also, and roughly they came to this model, but it became refined much later during this Siddhantic period. Yes. So I said after Thuban left the pole, there was another star nearest to north central pole, but it was 85 degrees away. That was 5 degrees away. It has to be at 90 degrees. This was 5 degrees away, and 7 degrees away was in the Kokab or so, which is in Ursa Minor. It would have been far away. They would not have been considered as pole star. It's a fixed star. Westerners might have considered for the northern direction, it was an indicator. Even other cultures might have considered. Our culture also might have considered. They could not have called it a Dhruva because Dhruva had to be fixed. Now, the same information I have put it here, except one extra thing which comes from the Vishnu Purana. Vishnu Purana says that Vishnu gave the Vara to Dhruva that all your life you will be near me in that is along with Vishnu. Not only that, your mother will be along with you as a star in the sky, always with you. And you can see this is the Vishnu of the Vedas. So Dhruva is here and his mother Suniti is here, a star here on the same constellation as a star which you can locate here. So it cannot be just a chance kind of thing. So it is something which is observational and developed like that. Now, there are so many other things. I already mentioned about the importance of Meru to the Jains and the Buddhists. Mahabharata also has reference to moving of Dhruva. In the Bhishma Parva during the war, it says, Dhruva prajvalito goram apasavyam pravartate. Dhruva is moving apradakshina during the period as a bad omen. There are also other legends. You know that the marriage of Draupadi was held. Drupada held and the archery competition was there, hitting the Matsya. But where was it held? The name of the town is Shishumarapura. It was not the original place of Drupada. He built a new town. And where was the Shishumarapura? It was Prag Uttarena Nagarat. It was in the northeast direction. Because by that time, the Shishumara had shifted to the northeast from the north position. So that is how it was done. It is a very holy constellation, Shishumara. For the Vedics, even today it is a holy constellation, even though it might have been forgotten. So there is a legend of Nahusha. You know that Nahusha fell down and he became only a serpent. So who was this Nahusha? You can read the story, it comes up in various places. He went to heaven first. But why did he fall down? It was due to two reasons. He coveted Shashi, the wife of Indra. And Shashi says, again it's a story, you come on a palanquin which is carried by the holiest of the people on earth and in the whole world. That is the Saptarshis and Agastya. If the Saptarshis and Agastya carry you, you can come to me, not otherwise. So he goes on that. The Saptarshis and Agastya say, okay, Nahusha, we will carry you on our shoulders. But Agastya is a little bit slow, so he kicks Agastya. So who kicks? Nahusha kicks Agastya. And immediately Agastya says, you fall down to earth, you are no more fit to be in the sky. Now Agastya is in the south, as I told you already, the Canopus star. Saptarshis are in the north. Shishumara is just there. That is the Nahusha. And in fact, this identification was done by a German for the first time. I'm not going to the details here. That Nahusha legend is actually a precision legend, and Nahusha is identifiable with Shishumara. The name might have been forgotten. Instead of Shishumara, they might have called him Ajagara or a serpent, because it looks more like a serpent now rather than as a whale. In the olden time, it was looking like a whale, you know. Well, anyway, this I will skip it. This is also in various other texts, like one I am working for the ICHR now, a manuscript, which is called the Vriddha Garbha Jyotusha, which is around 500 BC. Then also the Shishumara things come up. If somebody is interested in Sanskrit research, you know, you can come to me, I will talk to you on these things. There are also other things like the Bhagavata, which at a later period, which gives other information. So slowly Shishumara is forgotten and nobody knows about Shishumara anymore. They won't call it. Now Shishumara in Bhagavata is the whole of the sky universe is called Shishumara Mandala, and that is how I understand a temple also has been built. So the meaning keeps on changing. But Bhagavata itself is very clear. It says only for meditation it is used. But that is not the real Shishumara, it says. Now Puranas are compilations of legends transmitted, so we have to be careful in interpreting. But some of these Puranas were true, written in the Gupta period. They have contained information about the Gupta history, but also they remember some of these things. Otherwise, how could they have done? How could they have known these things? So it is transmitted in the tradition. This has been investigated, I mean, peculiarly by foreigners more than by us. There is a book by R.L. Thompson, who was a nuclear physicist and an astronomer, on astronomy, cosmology of the Bhagavata Purana. What he was interested in was the concept of Meru, Dhruva sitting at the center, and what kind of projective geometry they were using. Because in the later Puranas, there is a two-dimensional geometry is what is given. And everybody thinks, Puranas think of flat earth and all that. It's all absurd. They had a projective geometry, and that projective geometry, two people have worked. This is closely, I have given the reference here. And these were the origins. What they did was, like in engineering, we are all taught, you want to, you look from the top, you can draw the plan of this, I look from the bottom, or you look from front, you get the elevation. Same thing, they imagined a particular posture for looking at things. They went on roughly putting up what may be the distances and all that. They are not the distances of actual one planet to another planet as we imagine today. It was not. It was actually a projected distance. And this has been shown by two Americans very well. And this was the origin for what are called astrolabes. So astrolabes are actually kind of astronomical instruments, which in India developed extensively after 7th century AD and also by the Arabs and Persians. Many of the astrolabes are kept in Aligarh Muslim University, Lucknow Museum in Bihar and other places. In India there are plenty actually. There was a period when astrolabe manufacturing was peaked in India. And these are the two-dimensional astronomy pictures. And in fact from Dhruva, even the concept of Dhruvaka came for the Siddhantic astronomers. There is a polar longitude, even though there was no Dhruva, they took it as only globe and a point. That is a geometric pole is what they took. Even Brahmagupta and others do the same thing, but this I have to cover because Al-Biruni is an important person because he has an objective way of presenting Indian history from his own perspective. He came to India in 10th and 11th century, you know, the invasion of outsiders and the destruction of Somnath and all that. He was along with that. He was a eyewitness for all of that. He has written in his book called India, and he talks of a constellation called Fish, and he may actually derisive, but a very intelligent man. He learned Sanskrit, he read the books, he translated them into Persian, many of them, including the Yoga Sutra, because Yoga Sutra also Dhruva is very important, and that has been forgotten unfortunately by many of us. And he said it is the fish which was in the 10th century in this position, roughly towards the north. And he says the Hindus tell rather funny stories, speaking of the figure in which they represent the group of stars. It's a four-footed aquatic animal, it's a Shakwara and also Shishumara. I suppose the latter animal is the great lizard. He says there Dhruva is supposed to be in the great lizard, which is all absurd. And he also keeps on telling the pole itself is Vishnu, they all say, and he laughs at this kind of thing. He gives more information. He translated the Yoga Sutra. Many people do not know that he translated to Persian the Yoga Sutra. This was retranslated to English in this century, in 1983, by four authors. You can see the four authors' names, quite funny. Pines, Gelblum, Al-Biruni and Patanjali. So they not only interacted with the first two authors across the globe, also across time, you know, they interacted. It's a four author paper published like this in the same way. That's why I have taken this. And showed the meaning of this sutra, Yoga Sutra, Dhruve Tadgati Jnanam. This Tadgati refers to the Dhruva's Gati. That is the pole star's movement can be found out by concentrating on that. And Al-Biruni gives great details, and he also makes fun. Vishnu Dharma says, if you know this, your age will be increased by 14 years. Whereas he says, there are people in Persia who know thousands of stars, but these people say 14 stars, you know it, and your life will be increased by 14 years. Yes, but the meaning was in the Puranas, which belongs to a more ancient period, has to be fixed. That unless you forget the number 14, you may identify the Shishumara in some other manner. That was the idea with which they had to say where is the head, where is the tail, where is the stomach and all that they had to give. So this also says indirectly the pole star of the ancient period was in that lizard or in Draco, because the Persians in that period called Draco as lizard. And lizard was a word used even in Sanskrit. Later on Godha also was used. This is the astrolabe I was mentioning. In 1500 AD, there was a astronomer by name Padmanabha who developed an instrument for finding out time. So this instrument is available still, you can see that. He connected the Ursa Minor, the today's pole star, which was not yet in the pole, but it was almost very near the pole, with another star, and he showed that it rotates in the night like a clock, except you know that it takes 4 minutes less for the star rise, that's all, but he did that. And this has been done by one S.R. Sharma, who was professor at Aligarh Muslim University, and he has written books and is a great Sanskrit scholar also. He is right now settled in Germany. And the other astronomers, the Siddhantic astronomers, they always called it Dhruva Matsya, because it was fixed. The Matsya was fixed, there is no problem. The constellation was fixed, but not the star Dhruva of the Shishumara. So the Sanskrit word Dhruva means fixed, no doubt. But this was not the Shishumara. They did not refer to that at all. They all knew the Puranic story. They carefully avoided in the 8th century. But there is a person who did not care about these things. That was Shankaracharya. So Shankaracharya said in one of his commentaries on what is called a Vishnu Sahasranama. Vishnu Sahasranama is a religious text uttered by many people in the evenings and so on and so forth. There are 1000 names of Vishnu. One is Nakshatranemi. He explains that Nakshatranemi and he says Vishnu, Vishnu Hridayam Itaitiri Aranyakam. That is what you have to take. Vishnu has to be taken like that. And he also says Shishumarasya Puchya Desha Vyavastito Dhruvaha. This is the important statement. It is in the end of Shishumara, not the Dhruva Matsya, what the astronomers of his contemporary times were talking, 7th century, 8th century. After all, Shankara was in 8th century. So he is very clear on that. Not only that, his commentator further, of belonging to the same Vedic tradition, he says further, it has to be, the details are here, it looks like, see Shishumara is a Jalajantu Vishesha, he says, Sarata Goda Akaraha Tadakrati Dyochish Chakra Shishumara Chakra. He also says that it has to look like a lizard. Make careful. Sarata and Godar, either the garden lizard or the house lizard. It has to look like that. And the tip which is rising like this, you have to take it as Dhruva. Why was this important for these Vedic people? Because in the evening times, the meditation had to be done turning to the north and meditating on the Dhruva Chakra, the Shishumara Chakra. It is Vishnu and all others, they have to do the meditation. And not only the Shankara branch, the Ramanuja branch also gives a description of this. They also gave the same thing. And the third one, the Madhvacharya branch also accepts the same Vedic things. So there are two things which were parallel. One, the astronomers taking Dhruva Matsya, and the other one going in other direction. And you can see this has continued to this day. Looking at the Dhruva. Now, what the Purohit shows and what the husband shows to the wife, I don't know. But as a religious custom, it is continuing. Somewhere they show and in the night or in the morning and things like that. And this became a bone of contention for the Indologists because they wanted to find out the date of the Rig Veda and all that. So there is a German by name Jacobi who argued that, see, the Grihi Sutras, the marriage rituals were written only in 500 BC. There was no pole star at that time. But these Hindus show the pole star even now during the marriages. How did they know about the pole star? So he said it should have been possible only in 3000 BC. The Rig Veda should go to 3000 BC. But the proponents of the AIT, the Aryan invasion theory, it was very difficult for them to accept it. Because Sanskrit had to come into India only around 1500 BC. If it comes before that, their theories are gone. So Whitney and Keith were the proponents. They left and right argued against it, and they used such words, you would say the unbecoming. Now, star not too distant would have satisfied both the newly wedded woman and the exhibitor. What kind of language he uses for that, you can say. One you know, need not assume and all this and so on and so forth. He just did not know there was Dhruva in the Taittiri Aranyaka, or he knew it and he suppressed it. So this is, I have already said it. And Keith is studied even to this day. He was working in India in the India office, very influential person, very intelligent. He is the man who has translated Yajur Veda and several of the Sanskrit texts into English, I would say wrong English, well, wrong translations. Nevertheless, that is what is studied, unfortunately, by many of us. Now, unless you know the original and you know the other things, you will not be able to compare. And he also you see, used very bad words. So to say, he said foolish reasons for preferring one or the others. And he also says accuracy in the demands of a primitive wedding ritual which is wholly unnatural. What does he mean by primitive wedding ritual? He would have seen many of them, and he doesn't think that, you know, doing something symbolically and all that has a greater universal meaning. He thinks that is primitive unless it is done in the Western way. And he also puts a footnote that pole star appears only in the Greek sutras. Observed, I have shown you, it appears in the other things also, and one can reasonably well argue this. So what did the marriage people do? What did the husband tell the wife in this? That mantra is also there. It says, you be like Dhruva, who is connected to the heavens and to the earth as a fixed pole. You be in my house like that pole around which all others go around. That is, the father-in-law, mother-in-law, myself and everybody goes around you. That is the meaning of that mantra. But you know, that is how science develops. I will skip these things. I think I have covered all this. One can come up with a brief chronology if somebody is interested. I will skip this also. Yeah, this is what I call scientific naturalism, which I will be enlarging tomorrow. So naturalism is observing nature, sky, surroundings, etc., etc. Science is observation, classification, generalization, numbering, counting, pattern recognition. Broadly, I am putting up. Modern parlance, this falls under data collection, mathematical modeling. These people did all of that in their own way. Like, you know, I may go wrong or you may go wrong in some of the things. They might have also gone wrong somewhere. But the intellectual tradition, the same IQ, I don't think they were in any way less intelligent than us, or we are more intelligent than they. But the world views were different. They took the world view that the whole universe is together and they are one part and parcel of that universe. Whereas we are taking the view, we are separated out from so many things, and we are going in some other direction. That is philosophy, I will not go into that. Yeah, so this is the Dhruva who through his penance became the pole star. Thank you very much. Today I will be presenting one of the activities of that kind. The remaining more historical issues, more well established evidences, which I have brought out as a book also, the book is kept outside exhibition, I will be taking up tomorrow. Now if you see our ancient text, read any of either the Puranas or even the Vedic texts, many times, you know, the objects, what we today call objects, they are personified. There are legends, there are myths, there are stories about them. And they would be talking of demons, they would be talking of rakshasas, or they would be talking of divine beings flying here and there, all kinds of things. Some of these you can easily say, look, this is a physical kind of object from today's perspective as an engineer or as a scientist. Say, if a demon fell down from sky on the earth and a hole was made and he went inside, this kind of story comes up in the Puranas. It should only be a meteorite, a rock falling and making a crater and going down. In Puranas there are many such things. In fact, these are geological kind of myths. These are called in modern times geomyths, and earth scientists do work on geomyths in all countries, not only in India. And for international development of geological sciences, earth sciences in the most ancient period, geomyths are very important. Location of craters, they are done through these kind of mythical things only. Otherwise, you can't easily locate a crater. There would have been residents, silt and all kinds of things. Well, anyway, this personification has gone in so many ways in our text, the Sanskrit text. The legend of Dhruva, I will not explain it because this is my main topic. There are other legends like Somapana. Somapana, you know, is a drinking. People would take it lightly and say, even the villagers know that Indra drank Soma and he became, and all kinds of things, dramas are associated with it, so many things. But that Somapana, is it always a spirituous drink? Many of the Western Indologists write about Soma Yaga, Soma and all these things. They take it only in that sense that it was either a kind of a mushroom or something which they crushed and took it up and kind of, they might have done it. I am not telling it was not there. But Soma legend is not just that. So tomorrow we will say what is Soma legend and why, how many gods drank Soma, they count that number and given in the Rig Veda. So when, once numbers come, in fact science starts with numbers. So why did they count them? See, if you say something, you say the stars, nakshatras are 27, but 27 are the main nakshatras, there are totally 86. Each nakshatra has other groups and the count is given. How many are there is given. So that the whole thing is established in a proper manner to the accuracy available in those days. What are those days? That is the question. That is the history. So that is what I want to come to. And then there are also legends which can easily be associated with what is called precision. So today we know the earth rotates on its axis and as it rotates, it also makes the axis makes a slow motion as a top, as a spinning. It takes 27,000 years for one complete revolution. That is precession of the equinoxes. That legend is there in all cultures, not only in India, and that is there in these legends. I will come to it a little bit today, but more tomorrow. So there are so many other things, I will not go through it. It's the Parashara Tantra, as I said, because many read the ancient texts about Indian culture, people would say Indians knew only the lunar zodiac. They did not know about the solar zodiac. And they would say, compare this with the newspaper forecasts which are given, Rashi in Hindi and local languages, whereas sun signs in English newspapers say, look, they had this solar zodiac, you didn't have it. It's all absurd. So what was the technical issue with solar zodiac we have to see? Not with the astrology, is the scientific thing. Later on, astrology might have taken some scientific aspects and became another subject altogether, based mainly on quite a few superstitions and other. Again, another interesting thing is there, which I will be covering tomorrow, that is on the 6 monthly eclipse periods of the lunar eclipse was known. You know that you would have heard that even in the high school textbooks it is written, sorrow cycle of 18 years, it was Babylonians knew it, or it was from the Chaldeans and the Indians took it and so on and so forth. And even today, if you know your Janma Kundali kind of business, there you know there is a Rahu Dasha which is valid for 18 years, so it is the eclipse cycle and all that it is said. But 18 years they knew in some other sense, but they knew a 6 monthly lunar eclipse period. How did they know it? And if there was mathematics already in those periods to know that at 6 months is a possibility, or was it an observation? If it is an observation, when did it happen? You can, through modern astronomy, it should be possible to establish, and it would give us a dating. So these are the interesting things which one can do along these lines. Then you know, of course, there are also the Puranas. I will slowly come to this, because the Puranas, after the Vedic period, there are many issues concerning Puranas. I will come to it again much later. Now, why this pole star I have to worry about? All of us have heard about Dhruva. I am sure. Has anybody who has not heard of the Dhruva legend? You can raise your hand, because I may know that also. You know? So I take it every one of you. Briefly, you know the legend that Dhruva was the son of king by name Uttanapada. And he had the king had two wives, Suniti and Suruchi. Dhruva was the son of the first queen, Suniti. But the second queen was dearer to the king. So he was always partial to the second wife and her son, but not to the first one. So then Dhruva was one day goes to the father's thing, and then all those stories I will not repeat it. Then he goes and does tapas as a child. And then after several hundred years or thousand years or whatever, he realizes Vishnu and then so on and so forth, and he gets a boon that he can become the pole star, because the pole star always remains fixed. So you are Dhruva. So the meaning of the word Dhruva is important in Sanskrit. It means fixed. So the property of the star we are talking is to be fixed. should not know. Please remember that, because that question is important for our analytical investigation further. Now today, if I talk of a pole star, this is what we do. This is the pole star, is the Saptarshi, the Big Bear, and one would say draw a straight line from this, you can meet the pole star. Roorkee in the beautiful skies, you can see it in the night if you have not seen, and you can locate this pole star. And what is the pole star as per the International Astronomical Union? It is here. It is the last star on the Ursa Minor constellation. There is a constellation and also stars, you have to discriminate, because even in Sanskrit these discriminations are there, even though unfortunately they are forgotten. And this is the star, and it is going to be the pole star, means fixed means it will be here. But what is it which rotates then? If it has to be fixed, it is relative always. With reference to what it is fixed, these things rotate. In the night if you see, these rotate, these stars, but this remains there only. And if it is a slightly far away, this also would rotate. This please remember, because later on in the Puranas, it describes the rotation of Dhruva also. That is why it is important. Now, from modern astronomy, we know that, and when I heard this story as a young boy, and later on when I was reading the Sanskrit books in the originals as he was mentioning, I came across this, and then I wondered, how is it the modern astronomers say something else? As per modern astronomy, I will come to this again later on, there was no pole star for a long period from about 2000 BC to about 1500 AD. There was no pole star. The present pole star came to its position. This is another diagram which we will explain later on. This is the Polaris. 2000 AD only it has come. Actually 1500 AD it came very near that. Before that it was not there. And the modern analysis says, in 3000 BC there was a pole star called Thuban, that is the modern name, that is the pole star. And this was the pole star which was known to the Egyptians. This is the pyramids you can see. You can do a Google search, you can find out. There is a big theory on that. In the pyramid, you know, the king's chamber was aligned with Thuban, and they show that the openings are like this and which go directly to the northern constellation. That constellation is called Draco. That is called Draco even today. The modern astronomy is called Draco. This is the argument given, and we know that Egyptian things can be dated, has been dated to around 3000 BC without much difficulty based on other considerations, and hence this is a possibility, and they say that this is the philosophy behind them. They had to be kept, the mummies, seeing the Draco, because heaven was supposed to be there. That was the heaven. That is where they wanted to go or whatever. You can see later on there is some correspondence here also in our literature also on that. So my interest was in this, and I will just show you what you see. This yellow thing is the sun. This is the ecliptic. This is earth which is inclined 23 degrees. You see the northern axis where it is pointing. These are the stars which you see in the north. And these two points are the equinoxes. Yeah, the same figure which I showed previously, because earth and the ecliptic, they are inclined, the axes are inclined, and like a top, it makes a slow motion for 27,000 years to complete one circle, nearly 27,000 years. So you can see that, I think we can remove that. Yeah, we can go back to the original one, you know. Yeah, you can close it. So, between the previous, we have seen that short movie, the pole star, what human beings were able to see on the earth, in the northern hemisphere I am telling, I am not talking about the southern hemisphere, it changed from 3000 BC to nearly 1500 AD. There were some minor other stars which are near the north pole, but they are not fixed, they were not Dhruvas. Dhruvas there were only two, what we have today and what was there, the Thuban, about around 3000 BC. Now the next step is, in Indian literature, Sanskrit literature, also there are two dhruvas. A dhruva came up much later, around 1500 AD. I will show you that. The astronomers were very strong in India from Aryabhatta onwards. You know, they looked at the sky, they did all kinds of mathematical computations, very advanced mathematical things they did. What did they do about dhruva? They called, there was a dhruva matsya, there was a fish, it was called a dhruva matsya. That is the name they gave for a constellation near the North Pole. They did not talk about the Vedic dhruva. There is a very interesting thing which comes up, and when you see such a dichotomy or differences, you can see there should be some secret there. Some peculiar information is contained of cultural importance or religious importance, what you may say. So how to investigate it? So the oldest literature, you have to do only a literature review, nothing more than that. That means you have to read the ancient texts. I started with the oldest one which is available, that is the Vedas. So many of you would have been already exposed to the Vedas also. They are large, in fact there are about 200 texts which are considered Vedic. Even though there are only four actually with two branches of Vedas, and each have four arms. This itself will make you 20 important books. But there are ancillary books are there which multiplied by another 5 and 10, there are about 200 books or so. Now what is the fidelity of this text, what is the accuracy of this text is the next question. Because as I said, there are many things which are legendary, which are in a kind of anthropomorphic way, but it is about the sky. So when they talk about the sky, let them talk about a war in the sky. So what is it? How did they come to that conclusion there is a war in the sky? What did they observe? Is there anything which is correlatable linguistically and also scientifically with some scientific issues, what we call sciences today? Important thing is, science need not have been done in the only way that we are doing today. This is the Western way of doing, this is the Aristotelian way as they call it, from whom it has come, and we are doing it. Fine, perfectly fine, nothing wrong in it, but the need not be the only way. What is the alternate? The alternate that we had was what I would call a scientific naturalism. So how did that scientific naturalism came up? You can see a brief I am going to give in this. So what I did was I went through so many texts and finally homed up on a text called Taittiriya Aranyakam, which belongs to the Krishna Yajurveda. This is available in print nowadays. Why I am mentioning this is available in print? All these texts were oral, let us remember that. They were orally transmitted for 1000 years or more, thousands of years, and sometime they were put on palm leaf manuscripts. Not all, but many of them were put on palm leaf manuscripts. Palm leaf manuscripts stay only for 200 years, 300 years. Then somebody will have to rewrite. If it is not rewritten, it is gone. It is totally gone. So we don't know what has gone. But what is available in oral tradition to this day and the manuscripts, large number have been printed, fortunately, after 1850. And this text is very interesting. I am just making a brief presentation so you get a feeling to what this text is about. This is all on, the contents is about earth and the sky. Most of the things in the Vedic text are about the earth, atmosphere and the sky. Large number of things are concerned with it. That is the environment in which we are living. And that is the environment which they also talk. They talked in a different language. We have to convert it and see whether there is anything which overlaps with our sense. And I am not going to do anything, any interpretation on my own. I will not do that. Tradition itself has given some interpretation. Those traditional interpretation of ancient Sanskrit texts themselves will lead to some scientific conclusions. This text very beautifully says, Smritihi Pratyaksham Aitihyam. It's a Sanskrit club, so I should read it in Sanskrit. Anumanas Chatushtayam Yetaihi Aditya Mandalam Sarvaireva Vidasyate. Smriti Pratyaksha. Smriti is memory. Pratyaksha is directly seeing, observation. Aitihyam, it is a legendary or what our previous people have said. And Anumana, that is inference, the logic. These are the four things with which what can be done. Sarvaireva, all can understand Aditya Mandalam. Sun can be understood by anyone by these four methods. That is what it starts with. That is the premise. So once a person starts with such a premise, you can say whether it is scientific or unscientific. They might have come to wrong conclusion is a different matter. I am not bothered about it. But the approach is 100% scientific. And later on, Why they did this? They started with the seasons. They had to establish the seasons. It is easy for people to say that agricultural country, so they looked into the lunar calendar, solar calendar and all that, and it depend on the rain. Okay, but how did they establish the seasons? Is it that from the day the first rain falls, I call it Varsha Ritu or the rainy season? It cannot be done. Is it that the winter season starts exactly when I feel shivering? So it is a transition region, as we know that there is a transition. It is not a quantum jump which happens like that. How did the transition to be fixed? It is very important. They did it anecdotally by social considerations. The social considerations was, if somebody is kind of having rough eye and akshidukha, he says, and it is tears are falling and his eyes have become yellow, then it is going to be starting of the Varsha Ritu is what he says. And he gives other considerations. I will not go into all the six. This is important because the foundation of astronomy is season determination, whether Indian, whether Babylonian. Because all Greek astronomy has been taken from Babylonia. The fundamentals are all taken from Babylonia. The Babylonian astronomy is initially season zodiac, four seasons, whereas we had six seasons. That difference is the key factor which tomorrow I will discuss. But this text discusses the season, that is why I started with it, because it's fundamental to astronomy. Then it also talks about the stars, rishis who have become stars. And these rishis are the most important for our discussion here. Who are these? Rishayah sapta atrishchayate sarve atrayo agastyascha nakshatray shankruto avasan. This is a mantra. It is repeated in all religious functions and all that. What it means is, the seven stars, these saptarshis, which you know is the Ursa Major, which is there even now, you can identify easily. And not only that, Agastya. Agastya is a southern star. They are living with the nakshatras, is this statement. That means it should have happened after their time. After their sojourn on the earth, they were identified with the stars. That belief even today continues, that good people become stars in the sky and all that. All over India such legends are there. And once you see, get such a statement, you can believe in the text to a large extent, because it is giving some physical relationship with the sky. Because always sky and the earth were connected in the Vedic period. They did not isolate as we have isolated ourselves, but they thought they were one with the universe. So like the sky, they were also living maybe here, but they were one with the sky. Now, why this is important, you will see in the next slide. Agastya is a very interesting star. Now, saptarshis, if you had known, they are circumpolar. They used to be circumpolar, not anymore, but they used to be. That means they would never set. They would always be in the visible in the night times in the northern direction. Such stars are of interest, no doubt, but there are stars which have visibility in them. Visibility means only during certain periods in a year they are visible, otherwise they are not visible. That is, the visibility factor comes into picture. Now, Agastya is one such star, so important for our history. So what is that history, you can see here. This is a paper in 2005 by Iyengar, who was professor of astronomy in University of Hyderabad. He is a very famous astronomer. And in fact, it is important for Parashara Tantra, my book also, that is why I am showing. He showed that this southern star Canopus, as it is called in modern astronomy, which you can easily simulate on any of your planetarium software and see. After all, this is a shot I have taken from the Stellarium software. Agastya would have been visible in North India, that is in this region, only after about 3500 BC. Before 3500 BC, Agastya was not visible, again due to precession. So as precession comes into picture, some of the southern stars come and they vanish after a long time. And this has been calculated, you can see for Delhi, it was somewhere around 3100, 3500 BC. After another 3000 years, it will no more be visible in these latitudes. And if you go still north to Jammu, only around 1500 BC it was visible. And later on, it will vanish after another 1500 years. But in the south, of course, it was visible even earlier, around 8000 BC. But for the Vedic thing, we are considering only the Indo-Gangetic plain. The Saraswati River basin is the northern region, is what I am considering. So this is important for dating purposes. What I am showing here is from the Parashara's thing, because Taittiriya Aranyaka already showed, mentioned about Agastya. This is Agastya, was visible in -1300, that is 1300 BC from Pushkar. But remember this, and I have given two more information here. Why is it important? It is invisible even today if you go north of 34 degrees. It is visible only for people living south of 34 degrees north latitude. That is, it is visible to us. It is not visible in Rome, it is not visible in Greece. They would not have seen this. Some southern tip they might have come and seen, otherwise it is not visible. Russia, no, just Moscow and those, they don't know because they are going towards the north. And hence all Agastya legends, there are plenty of Agastya legends in India, and Agastyodaya is a religious function in North India, particularly in Bengal. During September or so, the almanacs give the date of Agastyodaya and they have to do some worship and all that. This gives us very interesting further information on chronology. Yeah, this is the book which I have shown in greater detail, in Kurukshetra when it was visible, in Pushkar when it was visible, from which date. Visible initially only for 10 days, 15 days. You don't expect a person to have seen it and then recorded it. It should have been visible for a longer time than only. Morning visibility, evening visibility, that is also important. It is a south star. It is not an eastern star like the regular nakshatras. Hence, this is a very important information. Now, what is the next thing? Why that Vedic text I have been talking? I showed you about Saptarshi, it knows. It knows about Agastya, so you can believe it. One northern constellation, one southern star. It also knows one more, that is where Dhruva comes into picture. This is a mantra. So, we think that all the Vedic things are holy, sacred, no doubt they are for us because it's already 5000 years old, we have to respect them. This is a mantra which is uttered even today, supposed to be for meditation. So, Dharmo Murdhanam Brahma Uttara Hanuhu Yajna Adhara Vishnuhu Hridayam, it goes like this. And it comes, then says Puchasya Prathamam Kandam, that is a tile somewhere, and that tile's first part is Indra, then comes Prajapati, then the fourth one is going to be Abhaya, he is called. Agni, then Indra, then Prajapati, then the fourth one is Abhaya, is the name which is given. But what is this figure? This figure, the mantra itself says further, because it is a very archaic way of telling things. Sava yesha divyaha shakvaraha shishumaraha. This person whom I explained previously, he is a divine celestial shakvara, is an animal. Shakvara is an animal in Sanskrit. It is a celestial animal. This is the celestial animal figure. And what did it say previously? How did it describe the animal figure? It is again interesting. It says the head is Dharma, is called Dharma. The Brahman is the upper jaw, Uttara Hanuhu. Yajna is the lower jaw. Vishnu is the Hridayam, is the heart of this figure is Vishnu. Then it says so many things, where are the Ashwins and where are the Mitra Varanas, and at the tip is, who is called Abhaya. And this Abhaya is identified with, I have given one table here, this is the Puranic names. The Puranic names are same, I will come to the Puranic thing slightly later. Except this Brahma is replaced by Uttanapada, whose son is Dhruva actually, as per this story. And the same mantra continues and says Dhruvastvamasi Dhruvasya Kshitamasi. You are the fixed person. You are the fixed person around whom all living beings go around you, and I salute you Shishukumaraya Namaha. And this is the Shishumara, who is also called the here Shishumara sometimes in some readings, Shishukumara in some other readings. Both of you can take it. And Shishumara is actually a animal, a whale, a gharial, or a crocodile, or a porpoise. It is an aquatic animal. This aquatic animal thing is also important for our discussion. Come to that. Now, I will quickly go through these things. I have already translated. This is the constellation Shishumara. Like you had the constellation of Prajapati, you had other constellations. This is a constellation because it is the important question, because some of the Western astronomers, historians write that Indian astronomy did not know about representing constellations with animal figures. So the Mesha Vrishabha are supposed to be later ones borrowed from the Greeks. Whereas this is an animal figure and this is a constellation. Why this is a constellation? Is it correct? We have to go through these things a little bit further more. Yeah, if we followed so far what we have done, we can go to a planetarium figure. This is 2830 BC. This is how the pole star would have been there, and the constellation you can identify in those days is only this. This is what is called in modern times a Draco. And this looks like a peculiar animal, a whale or a crocodile figure, if you can imagine that on the board, or you can try your luck even in the sky and come to your own conclusion. But the moderns represent the Greeks as a dragon. So this is the figure which is given, if you want a figure for it, as per the modern astronomical mythology you want it. Now, this is the International Astronomical Union figure. Official figure for Draco is here. I think you can't see that clearly, but this is the present day Ursa Minor, but Draco is here. You can later on see that also. And Allen is a very famous person. He's an astronomer. His book is referred even to this day, Star Names and Their Meanings. He says he knew that the Hindus, from whom the Greeks are said to have borrowed, although the reverse of this may also have been the case, knew it as Shishumara, that is the Draco, he says, but there are alternates given because that is our own mistake. Because many times you use the same word for several objects, and that is where the difficulty is coming. This I have already explained to you the top example also in your classes, this would have been given. And you see a better figure here. This is the Draco figure, and this is the Abhaya, which I was mentioning during the Vedic period. This is the only thing, this is the polar circle. Unless and until a star is on this, it is not a fixed pole star. It can indicate a northern direction. That is possible, because you would see in the books people who oppose, we'll come to that if there is time later on, they will say so many other things also, but you can see the fixed one could have been only in 2800 BC to 3000 or plus or minus 100 years. If you go by this, this star should have been identified as the Vishnu, called Sadhya Vishnu in the Vedic period. Not that they took Vishnu was sitting there or anything. Let us not make that mistake. They had a region deities, that is the forces or some powers which are identified with the various celestial objects, because they could not go there. So they identified some names, like the Saptarshis were given names, Atri, Bhrugu, Kutsa kind of thing. Here also they gave some names of gods, which are going to be Brahma, Dhruva, all these things. Later on, the Puranas, to continue this story, otherwise you know this is dry and Vedic thing which you have to utter it with so many modulations and all that people would forget. It has to go to the common people also. So the Puranas developed their mythologies to preserve these things. So it is important, science also has to be preserved for the common man. How do you do it? It is not telling A plus B whole square equals this, that nobody will listen, they will go out. You have to put it in some other way, in a figurative way. That is what has been done. Now, another important question, you can oppose me. If you have any opposition, you can also raise your hand and ask me. If it was so, that in 3000 BC, the Aranyaka, what it says, was in fact the Thuban of the Draco constellation, and it was the Dhruva, what happened to it later on? Because you yourself said, modern astronomy says there was no Dhruva from 1500 BC to 1500 AD. Then how do you argue about it? Yes, you can see that there is a reference and evidence for that in the Sanskrit texts themselves. That what they were calling Dhruva as fixed, there is a text called Maitraini Aranyaka, again of the Yajurveda. It's a very beautiful thing, because it gets into Vedanta and all that. But Vedantic things I will not cover up here. The king by name Brihadratha questions a sage, everything is transient in this world. That is how this starts, sentence. And he goes on to say, his pessimism is so great and deep, Maharnavanam Shikarinam Prapatanam. Even the great things, you know, from the mountains, they are all falling down. Landslides maybe he was referring to. They are all falling down. And then Dhruvasya Prachalanam, even Dhruva is moving. Even Dhruva is moving. And Vatarajju na nimajjanam. This Vatarajju is supposed to be, I had no time for that, but it is in the Siddhantic astronomy that the planets, how are they controlled is the question. They is assumed there are invisible strings, you know, light strings or whatever, with the help of which they are controlled in their relative position, is what they say. That concept is from the Vedic period. This Vatarajjunam Nimajjana means even the planets which they were, he was imagining at a particular point, they have gone down. Which was visible has become invisible, precession effect again coming into picture, and vice versa. So there is definitely a reference that Dhruva was drifting. There is also more reference to this. And when this could have happened, this Maitraini Aranyaka itself has some statements which details I will not go into again, because it says the season of the cold season, the winter season, there is a winter solstice, started when sun was in the center of Dhanishta Nakshatra. Whereas in the Vedanga Jyotisha period, if it has already been covered by somebody, it was 1400 BC, whereas this would have been possible half star away, that is about 6.5 degrees prior. So 72 degrees precision, 72 years per degree, if you keep it, you can easily get about 450 years or so. And this is datable to about 1600 BC, this text or this statement. I won't say the text, because how the text came we don't know, it was oral, but this observation should belong to 1600 BC. So it is the same text which says why Dhruva is moving, which was not of text of 3000 BC or whatever, but of a later period. And you come to the Puranas, this is the Brahmanda Purana. See, the story of Dhruva as the legend, what you hear in the Kathas and Dhruva Katha and other things, you know, Haridwar and other places, that is from the Vishnu Purana, mostly from the Vishnu Purana. Whereas the Brahmanda Purana is a Purana earlier to Vishnu Purana. Brahmanda Purana doesn't have that legend of Dhruva sitting on the lap of his father and father. That is why this Purana is not popular. This is more a scientific Purana, because this is about cosmology. Brahmanda is cosmology. It discusses cosmology in the first half. In fact, excellent text, which I believe it should be about somebody's interested in how these things were studied. It's very simple Sanskrit, where Sanskrit club people can easily follow this, you know. It should be included in the curriculum. What it says, it discusses the Shishumara here, and in about 250 verses, it discusses astronomy of its days, a modeling, and also Dhruva. And where is Dhruva? It says, Bhuta Samhohanam Etate, I can't read it, Nibodhata, something, Pratyakshmapi Drishyancha Samoheti Yat Prajaha. It says, you see in the northern sky, there is something there which mesmerizes you. It is something is so interesting, it mesmerizes you. What is that mesmerizing thing which is happening? He says, Uttanapada Putraso Medi Bhuto Dhruvo Divi. The son of Uttanapada has become the fixed Medi. That is the pivot of the whole earth. He has become the pivot. And that, why is he saying that? Savai Brahmayate Nityam Chandraditya Grahisaha. He is controlling Chandra and Surya along with all the planets. He is rotating them, he says. So this is not geocentric, this is not heliocentric, this is Dhruva-centric. Says the Dhruva is controlling and holding them. But where is the motive power? He explains that also further. Well, anyway, there are so many things, and he gives two models. One is called the Tailapeeda Yatha Chakram. Tailapeeda is a Gani, it's an oil mill. I think Kanjarpur may still have a Gani, I don't know. It may be there, which is the oil mill. I will show the figure later on. That is one of the models. The other model he gives is the Potter's wheel. The Potter's wheel also is something like that. And he discusses in very great detail, all the 14 stars are given. And this 14 is important. The number is important, even in the Veda, even in the Purana, everywhere. That 14 star he keeps on. And we have a conflict with Al-Biruni when we come to the 11th century. Till that time, we have no conflict with this number 14. And that has itself a story behind it. Now, he says that, and also they are so particular, the last four do not set. Is the circumpolar, the last four of this constellation which I showed. Why are they telling that? It was important for navigation. when the Vedic text knew this, it's a circumpolar star, you can use it for navigation. There is a mantra in another text which is used for navigation. It says it is a Shishumara mantra. That is, use it for navigation, you will safely cross the ocean, it says. They took an equivalent in not only cross the physical ocean on the earth, you can also cross the samsara ocean also philosophically by worshipping the Shishumara who is in the sky. That is the connection they had, because always sky and the earth were connected. This is a very long thing, so I will come to this. This is the, you can see the potter wheel. What he wants to say is, the Dhruva is sitting here, the all other things are rotating, he is slowly rotating, no doubt. But he is sitting also, he is fixed also in the center. That is how you have to take it. And he says that, Kulala Chakra Nabhischa Yata Tatraiva Vartate. The center of the potter wheel stays there only, right? Like the Dhruva is also there, but he also rotates, everything is what he is telling. Then somebody thought they need a better model, that is the Grani model. So the comparison here is Tailapida Yata Chakravati. What he says is, this is the Medi. Medi means only a pole, you know. This is central pole is what is called Medi. Later on it became Meru. Today also that word is used. Siddhantic astronomers use that for cosmology. Jains and Buddhists also use this cosmology model. They don't use Dhruva, because by the time these philosophies evolved, there was no Dhruva, but they used this concept. So you can see how things get forgotten in culture, but the relevant concepts are remembered and they are used for some particular purposes. So what he says in the Purana is like an oil mill, this part, here of course the motive power is from the bullocks, they rotate this row. He says no, this is at the center, Dhruva is anyway rotating, forget how he is the god, he is the final power for everything. And he rotates and these are the planets. So the planets rotate, if you rotate this, they can also rotate. So he required only an inclined thing, that inclination is the obliquity. So they had an idea of the obliquity also, and roughly they came to this model. But it became refined much later during this Siddhantic period. Yes. So I said after Thuban left the pole, there was another star nearest to north central pole, but it was 85 degrees away. That was 5 degrees away. It has to be at 90 degrees. This was 5 degrees away, and 7 degrees away was in the Kokab or so, which is in Ursa Minor. It would have been far away. They would not have been considered as pole star. It's a fixed star. Westerners might have considered for the northern direction, it was an indicator. Even other cultures might have considered. Our culture also might have considered. They could not have called it a Dhruva, because Dhruva had to be fixed. Now, the same information I have put it here, except one extra thing which comes from the Vishnu Purana. Vishnu Purana says that Vishnu gave the Vara to Dhruva, that all your life you will be near me in that is along with Vishnu. Not only that, your mother will be along with you as a star in the sky, always with you. And you can see this is the Vishnu of the Vedas. So Dhruva is here and his mother Suniti is here, a star here on the same constellation as a star which you can locate it. So it cannot be just a chance kind of thing. So it is something which is observational and developed like that. Now, there are so many other things. I already mentioned about the importance of Meru to the Jains and the Buddhists. Mahabharata also has reference to moving of Dhruva. In the Bhishma Parva during the war, it says, Dhruva prajvalito goram apasavyam pravartate. Dhruva is moving apradakshina during the period as a bad omen. There are also other legends. You know that the marriage of Draupadi was held. Drupada held and the archery competition was there, hitting the Matsya. But where was it held? The name of the town is Shishumarapura. It was not the original place of Drupada. He built a new town. And where was the Shishumarapura? It was Prag Uttarena Nagarat. It was in the northeast direction, because by that time the Shishumara had shifted to the northeast from the north position. So that is how it was done. It is a very holy constellation, Shishumara. For the Vedics, even today it is a holy constellation, even though it might have been forgotten. So there is a legend of Nahusha. You know that Nahusha fell down and he became only a serpent. So who was this Nahusha? You can read the story, it comes up in various places. He went to heaven first. But why did he fall down? It was due to two reasons. He coveted Shashi, the wife of Indra, and Shashi says, again it's a story, you come on a palanquin which is carried by the holiest of the people on earth and in the whole world, that is the Saptarshis and Agastya. If the Saptarshis and Agastya carry you, you can come to me, not otherwise. So he goes on that, the Saptarshis and Agastya, yes, say, okay, Nahusha, we will carry you on our shoulders. But Agastya is a little bit slow, so he kicks Agastya. So who kicks? Nahusha kicks Agastya. And immediately Agastya says, you fall down to earth, you are no more fit to be in the sky. Now Agastya is in the south, as I told you already, the Canopus star. Saptarshis are in the north. Shishumara is just there. That is the Nahusha. And in fact, this identification was done by a German for the first time. I will not go into the details here. That Nahusha legend is actually a precision legend, and Nahusha is identifiable with Shishumara. The name might have been forgotten. Instead of Shishumara, they might have called him Ajagara or a serpent, because it looks more like a serpent now rather than as a whale. In the olden time, it was looking like a whale, you know. Well, anyway, this I will skip it. This is also in various other texts, like one I am working for the ICHR now, a manuscript, which is called Vriddha Garbha Jyotusha, which is around 500 BC. Then also the Shishumara things come up. If somebody is interested in Sanskrit research, you know, you can come to me, I will talk to you on these things. There are also other things like the Bhagavata, which at a later period, which gives other information. So slowly Shishumara is forgotten, and nobody knows about Shishumara anymore. They won't call it. Now Shishumara in Bhagavata is the whole of the sky, universe is called Shishumara Mandala, and that is how I understand a temple also has been built. So the meaning keeps on changing. But Bhagavata itself is very clear. It says only for meditation it is used. But that is not the real Shishumara, it says. Now Puranas are compilations of legends transmitted, so we have to be careful in interpreting. But some of these Puranas were true, written in the Gupta period. They have contained information about the Gupta history, but also they remember some of these things. Otherwise, how could they have done? How could they have known these things? So it is transmitted in the tradition. This has been investigated, peculiarly by foreigners more than by us. There is a book by R.L. Thompson, who was a nuclear physicist and an astronomer, on astronomy, cosmology of the Bhagavata Purana. What he was interested in was the concept of Meru, Dhruva sitting at the center, and what kind of projective geometry they were using. Because in the later Puranas, there is a two-dimensional geometry is what is given. And everybody thinks, Puranas think of flat earth and all that. It's all absurd. They had a projective geometry, and that projective geometry two people have worked. This is closely, I have given the reference here. And these were the origins. What they did was, like in engineering, we are all taught, you want to, you look from the top, you can draw the plan of this, you look from the bottom, or you look from front, you get the elevation. Same thing, they imagined a particular posture for looking at things. They went on roughly putting up what may be the distances and all that. They are not the distances of actual one planet to another planet as we imagine today. It was not. It was actually a projected distance. And this has been shown by two Americans very well. And this was the origin for what are called astrolabes. So astrolabes are actually kind of astronomical instruments, which in India developed extensively after 7th century AD and also by the Arabs and Persians. Many of the astrolabes are kept in Aligarh Muslim University, Lucknow Museum in Bihar and other places. In India there are plenty actually. There was a period when astrolabe manufacturing was peaked in India. And these are the two-dimensional astronomy pictures. And in fact from Dhruva, even the concept of Dhruvaka came for the Siddhantic astronomers. There is a polar longitude, even though there was no Dhruva, they took it as only globe and a point. That is a geometric pole is what they took. Even Brahmagupta and others do the same thing, but this I have to cover, because Al-Biruni is an important person, because he has an objective way of presenting Indian history from his own perspective. He came to India in 10th and 11th century, you know, the invasion of outsiders and the destruction of Somnath and all that. He was along with that. He was a eyewitness for all of that. He has written in his book called India, and he talks of in a constellation called Fish, and he may actually derisive, but a very intelligent man. He learned Sanskrit, he read the books, he translated them into Persian, many of them, including the Yoga Sutra, because Yoga Sutra also Dhruva is very important, and that has been forgotten unfortunately by many of us. And he said it is the fish which was in the 10th century in this position, roughly towards the north. And he says the Hindus tell rather funny stories speaking of the figure in which they represent the group of stars. It's a four-footed aquatic animal, it's a Shakwara and also Shishumara. I suppose the latter animal is the great lizard. He says there Dhruva is supposed to be in the great lizard, which is all observed, and he also keeps on telling the pole itself is Vishnu, they all say, and he laughs at this kind of thing. He gives more information. He translated the Yoga Sutra. Many people do not know that he translated to Persian the Yoga Sutra. This was retranslated to English in this century, in 1983, by four authors. You can see the four authors' names, quite funny: Pines, Gelblum, Alberuni and Patanjali. So they not only interacted with the first two authors across the globe, also across time, you know, they interacted. It's a four author paper published like this in the same way, that's why I have taken this. And showed the meaning of this sutra, Yoga Sutra, Dhruve Tadgati Jnanam. This Tadgati refers to the Dhruva's Gati. That is, the pole star's movement can be found out by concentrating on that. And you know, Alberuni gives great details, and he also makes fun. Vishnu Dharma says, if you know these, your age will be increased by 14 years. Whereas he says, there are people in Persia who know thousands of stars, but these people say 14 stars, you know it, and your life will be increased by 14 years. Yes, but the meaning was in the Puranas, which belongs to a more ancient period, has to be fixed. That unless you forget the number 14, you may identify the Shishumara in some other manner. That was the idea with which they had to say where is the head, where is the tail, where is the stomach, and all that they had to give. So this also says indirectly the pole star of the ancient period was in that lizard or in Draco, because the Persians in that period called Draco as lizard. And lizard was a word used even in Sanskrit. Later on, Goda also was used. This is the astrolabe I was mentioning. In 1500 AD, there was a astronomer by name Padmanabha who developed an instrument for finding out time. So this instrument is available still, you can see that. He connected the Ursa Minor, the today's pole star, which was not yet in the pole, but it was almost very near the pole, with another star, and he showed that it rotates in the night like a clock, except you know that it takes 4 minutes less for the star rise, that's all, but he did that. And this has been done by one S.R. Sharma, who was professor at Aligarh Muslim University, and he has written books and is a great Sanskrit scholar also. He is right now settled in Germany. And the other astronomers, the Siddhantic astronomers, they always called it Dhruva Matsya, because it was fixed. The Matsya was fixed, there is no problem. The constellation was fixed, but not the star Dhruva of the Shishumara. So the Sanskrit word Dhruva means fixed, no doubt, but this was not the Shishumara. They did not refer to that at all. They all knew the Puranic story. They carefully avoided in the 8th century. But there is a person who did not care about these things. That was Shankaracharya. So Shankaracharya said in one of his commentaries on what is called a Vishnu Sahasranama. Vishnu Sahasranama is a religious text uttered by many people in the evenings and so on and so forth. There are 1000 names of Vishnu. One is Nakshatra Nemi. He explains that Nakshatra Nemi, and he says Vishnu, Vishnu Hridayam Itaitirya Aranyakam. That is what you have to take. Vishnu has to be taken like that. And he also says Shishumarasya Puchya Desha Vyavastito Dhruvaha. This is the important statement. It is in the end of Shishumara, not the Dhruva Matsya, what the astronomers of his contemporary times were talking, 7th century, 8th century. After all, Shankara was in 8th century. So he is very clear on that. Not only that, his commentator further, of belonging to the same Vedic tradition, he says further, it has to be, the details are here, it looks like, see, Shishumara is a Jalajantu Vishesha, he says, Sarata Goda Akaraha, Tadakrati Jyotish Chakra Shishumara Chakra. He also says that it has to look like a lizard. Make careful. Sarita and Godar, either the garden lizard or the house lizard. It has to look like that. And the tip which is rising like this, you have to take it as Dhruva. Why was this important for these Vedic people? Because in the evening times, the meditation had to be done turning to the north and meditating on the Dhruva Chakra, the Shishumara Chakra. That is Vishnu and all others, they have to do the meditation. And not only the Shankara branch, the Ramanuja branch also gives a description of this. They also gave the same thing. And the third one, the Madhvacharya branch also accepts the same Vedic things. So there were two things which were parallel. One, the astronomers taking Dhruva Matsya, and the other one going in other direction. And you can see this has continued to this day, looking at the Dhruva. Now what the Purohit shows and what the husband shows to the wife, I don't know. But as a religious custom, it is continuing. Somewhere they show and in the night or in the morning and things like that. And this became a bone of contention for the Indologists because they wanted to find out the date of the Rig Veda and all that. So there is a German by name Jacobi who argued that, see, the Grihi Sutras, the marriage rituals were written only in 500 BC. There was no Polestar at that time. But these Hindus show the Polestar even now during the marriages. How did they know about the Polestar? So he said it should have been possible only in 3000 BC, and the Rig Veda should go to 3000 BC. But the proponents of the AIT, the Aryan Invasion Theory, it was very difficult for them to accept it. Because Sanskrit had to come into India only around 1500 BC. If it comes before that, their theories are gone. So Whitney and Keith were the proponents. They left and right argued against it, and they used such words, you would say the unbecoming. Star not too distant would have satisfied both the newly wedded woman and the exhibitor. What kind of language he uses for that, you can say. One need not assume and all this and so on and so forth. He just did not know there was Dhruva in the Taittiriya Aranyaka, or he knew it and he suppressed it. So this is, I have already said it. And Keith is studied even to this day. He was working in India in the India office, very influential person, very intelligent. He is the man who has translated Yajur Veda and several of the Sanskrit texts into English, I would say wrong English, I mean wrong translations. Nevertheless, that is what is studied unfortunately by many of us now. Unless you know the original and you know the other things, you will not be able to compare. And he also, see, used very bad words. So to say, he said foolish reasons for preferring one or the others. And he also says accuracy in the demands of a primitive wedding ritual which is wholly unnatural. What does he mean by primitive wedding ritual? He would have seen many of them, and he doesn't think that, you know, doing something symbolically and all that has a greater universal meaning. He thinks that is primitive unless it is done in the Western way. And he also puts a footnote that pole star appears only in the Grihi Sutras. Observed, I have shown you, it appears in the other things also, and one can reasonably well argue this. So what did the marriage people do? What did the husband tell the wife? In this, that mantra is also there. It says, you be like Dhruva, who is connected to the heavens and to the earth as a fixed pole. You be in my house like that pole around which all others go around. That is the father-in-law, mother-in-law, myself, and everybody goes around you. That is the meaning of that mantra. But you know, that is how science develops. I will skip these things. I think I have covered all this. One can come up with a brief chronology if somebody is interested. I will skip this also. Yeah, this is what I call scientific naturalism, which I will be enlarging tomorrow. So naturalism is observing nature, sky, surroundings, etc., etc. Science is observation, classification, generalization, numbering, counting, pattern recognition. Broadly, I am putting up. Modern parlance, this falls under data collection, mathematical modeling. These people did all of that in their own way. Like, you know, I may go wrong or you may go wrong in some of the things. They might have also gone wrong somewhere. But the intellectual tradition, the same IQ, I don't think they were in any way less intelligent than us, or we are more intelligent than they. But the world views were different. They took the world view that the whole universe is together and they are one part and parcel of that universe. Whereas we are taking the view, we are separated out from so many things, and we are going in some other direction. That is philosophy. I will not go into that. Yeah. So this is the Dhruva who, through his penance, became the pole star. Thank you very much.